Good afternoon and welcome, especially warm welcome if this is the first time you've been to the college. We're here to remember, to celebrate and to give thanks for the life of Eric Griffiths, a fellow of Trinity from 1980. A controversial figure, Eric had many admirers, and it is testament to that that so many are contributing to this afternoon's memorial event. It's a sadness that it is often only after death, at occasions such as this, that one learns much of the person that one might have known better. It is certainly true for me today, and I'm looking forward to the story that will unfold and to the words and music that will perhaps more powerfully give a sense of Eric's personality and the influences that inspired him. The plan is that the elements of this memorial will pass seamlessly one to the next without introduction. So thank you to all those who've planned the event and who will make the presentations.
Eric taught me Tennyson very memorably, and we principally concentrated on In Memoriam. However, I'm not going to read In Memoriam today because I think it's a bit too clotted to read out loud. So I've decided to do The Death of Arthur from The Idylls of the King, which is not a poem I think Eric liked, but at least it never came up in any of our lessons. So here goes. Slowly answered Arthur from the barge, "The old order changeth, yielding place to new, and God fulfills himself in many ways, lest one good custom should corrupt the world. Comfort thyself. What comfort is in me? I have lived my life, and that which I have done may he within himself make pure. But thou, if thou shouldst never see my face again, pray for my soul. More things are wrought by prayer than this world dreams of. Wherefore, let thy voice rise like a fountain for me night and day. For what are men better than sheep or goats that nourish a blind life within the brain, if, knowing God, they lift not hands of prayer, both for themselves and those who call them friend? For so the whole round earth is every way bound by gold chains about the feet of God. But now farewell. I am going a long way with these thou seest, if indeed I go, for all my mind is clouded with a doubt, to the island valley of Avilion, where falls not hail or rain or any snow, nor ever wind blows loudly, but it lies deep meadowed, happy, fair with orchard lawns and bowery hollows crowned with summer sea, where I will heal me of my grievous wound." So said he, and the barge with oar and sail moved from the brink like some full-breasted swan that, fluting a wild carol ere her death, ruffles her pure cold plume and takes the flood with swarthy webs. Long stood Sir Bedivere revolving many memories, till the hull looked one black dot against the verge of dawn, and on the mere the wailing died away. But when that moan had passed for evermore, the stillness of the dead world's winter dawn amazed him, and he groaned, "The king is gone." And therewithal came on him the weird rhyme, "From the great deep to the great deep he goes." Then from the dawn it seemed there came but faint, as from beyond the limit of the world, like the last echo born of a great cry, sounds as if some fair city were one voice around a king returning from his wars. Thereat once more he moved about and climbed even to the highest he could climb, and saw, straining his eyes beneath an arch of hand, or thought he saw, the speck that bare the king down that long water opening on the deep, somewhere far off, pass on, and go from less to less, and vanish into light. And the new sun rose, bringing the new year.
I have chosen a passage from Eric Griffith's The Printed Voice of Victorian Poetry. I've chosen it because Eric repeatedly, of the four last things, chose the one that comes first, death. That's the opening of that book, and it's the opening of his amazingly convincing 100 pages on Dante. To be or not to be? That is the question. Eric, many of us will remember, noted the way in which the question marks differ in the folio from those in the first quarto and the second quarto. He says, Hamlet is a play of questions and has a temperamentally questioning hero. And at that point, there came very felicitously the reminder of the gratitude that Eric owed to Adrian Poole, a footnote which speaks of his debt to Adrian Poole, a debt which is very, very important in that it brought Eric to Trinity College. Eric talks about the debate about what the question is, and then he moves to this. There is no the question here, because there are several questions. Someone might well believe, for instance, that it was better to suffer whatever occurred, and therefore not under any circumstances choose not to be. And he could give various, indeed mutually contradictory reasons, Stoic or Christian, for this belief. Or someone might claim that complete acquiescence in suffering is not really being alive at all, and that to be must encounter those risks which fighting against troubles involves, risks which include the risk of one's own death. It is possible to believe that not to be born is the best for man, and also to forbid suicide while enjoining absolute resignation. It's equally possible to think life in itself a good, but a good only in circumstances which essentially include being prepared to die for something, and so on. Now, the "and so on" would include Eric's memory of the poem by William Empson, which he is calling up. Eric changes the word ready to the word prepared, with the sense of a kind of discipline, a conscious discipline with which you do prepare, if you're Jeremy Taylor, holy living against holy dying or for holy dying. So here is the short poem by William Empson, Ignorance of Death, one of his great flat-tongued poems, and I think astonishing combination of astonishment and completely convincing. Then there is this civilizing love of death, by which even music and painting tell you what else to love. Buddhists and Christians contrive to agree about death, making death their ideal basis for different ideals. The communists, however, disapprove of death, except when practical. The people who dig up corpses and rape them are, I understand, not reported. The Freudians regard the death wish as fundamental, though the clamor of life proceeds from its rival, Eros. Whether you are to admire a given case for making less clamor is not their story. Liberal hopefulness regards death as a mere border to an improving picture. Because we have neither hereditary nor direct knowledge of death, it is the trigger of the literary man's biggest gun, and we are happy to equate it to any conceived calm. Heaven me, when a man is ready to die about something other than himself, and is in fact ready because of that, not because of himself. That is something clear about himself. Otherwise, I feel very blank on this topic and think that though important and proper for anyone to bring up, it is one that most people should be prepared to be blank upon.
I was 2 years ahead of Eric as a student reading English at Pembroke. This meant that when I became a postgraduate student, I taught Eric amongst a small group teaching practical criticism. I have to say, Eric was a rather daunting student to teach. He was ferociously intelligent, something that comes through in everything he subsequently lectured on and wrote. He knew he was ferociously intelligent too, but he was a wonderful student. I've chosen a poem by Wordsworth partly because I think Eric would have disapproved. It is, however, a terrific poem written in 1806, about a year or so after Wordsworth's brother John had died tragically at sea. The poem is entitled Elegiac Stanzas Suggested by a Picture of Peel Castle in a Storm, painted by Sir George Beaumont. This is Wordsworth looking at a painting by Beaumont depicting a very fierce sea, and he recalls how in much calmer weather he, Wordsworth, used to look across from where he lived at the ruins of Peel Castle for real. This was published in the poems in two volumes in 1807. It is one of the last flourishings of good Wordsworth before he descended into greater banality. Elegiac Stanzas. I was thy neighbor once, thou rugged pile. 4 summer weeks I dwelt in sight of thee. I saw thee every day, and all the while thy form was sleeping on a glassy sea. So pure the sky, so quiet was the air, so like, so very like was day to day. Whene'er I looked, thy image still was there. It trembled, but it never passed away. How perfect was the calm! It seemed no sleep, no mood which season takes away or brings. I could have fancied that the mighty deep was even the gentlest of all gentle things. Ah, then, if mine had been the painter's hand to express what then I saw, and add the gleam, the light that never was on sea or land, the consecration and the poet's dream, I would have planted thee, thou hoary pile, amid a world how different from this, beside a sea that could not cease to smile on tranquil land beneath a sky of bliss. Thou shouldst have seemed a treasure house divine of peaceful years, a chronicle of heaven, of all the sunbeams that did ever shine, the very sweetest had to thee been given. A picture had it been of lasting ease, Elysian quiet, without toil or strife, no motion but the moving tide, a breeze, or merely silent nature's breathing life. Such, in the fond illusion of my heart, such picture would I at that time have made, and seen the soul of truth in every part, a steadfast peace that might not be betrayed. So once it would have been,
'tis so no more. I have submitted to a new control. A power is gone which nothing can restore. A deep distress hath humanized my soul. Not for a moment could I now behold a smiling sea and be what I have been. The feeling of my loss will ne'er be old, this which I know I speak with mind serene. Then Beaumont, friend, who would have been the friend if he had lived of him whom I deplore, this work of thine I blame not but commend, this sea in anger and that dismal shore. Oh, 'tis a passionate work, yet wise and well chosen is the spirit that is here. That hulk which labors in the deadly swell, this rueful sky, this pageantry of fear. And this huge castle, standing here sublime, I love to see the look with which it braves, cased in the unfeeling armor of old time, the lightning, the fierce wind, the trampling waves. Farewell, farewell, the heart that lives alone, housed in a dream, at distance from the kind. Such happiness, wherever it be known, is to be pitied, for 'tis surely blind. But welcome fortitude and patient cheer, and frequent sights of what is to be borne. Such sights, or worse, as are before me here. Not without hope, we suffer and we mourn.
When I saw the running order for today's event, kicking off with Simon Russell Beale and Christopher Ricks, I was reminded of that story about The Who, who, when they played Monterey, added a special rider to the contract that they wouldn't have to come out on stage after Jimi Hendrix. In 1980, I was an undergraduate here. It was already a very vibrant English department under Adrian Poole's dynamic and charismatic leadership. It was an exciting place to be. And there was yet more excitement at the prospect of another young new English fellow arriving. He was known to be brilliant, with a slightly dark reputation for having a wild side, a reputation which Eric enjoyed cultivating. He was part of a very brilliant circle who were writing for Broadsheet at that time, a magazine which produced a disproportionate amount of influential critics later. So I was one of Eric's very first pupils at Trinity and remained a friend all his life, despite what he saw as my distressing lack of religion and equally distressing heterosexuality. He was an extraordinary and often very kind friend, and it's his kindness I particularly remember, particularly as people often underestimate that and think of him as a harder person than he was. He was kind to me, as he was to many of his former students. But staying friends with Eric could at times be quite hard work. He often had arguments with both friends and some of his more long-suffering colleagues. I was one of the very few people, I think, who he didn't have an argument with. And before this sounds smug, there's a reason for this, which I finally worked out. I think he thought I wasn't quite serious or clever enough for it to be worth it. Eric liked his arguments big and gladiatorial. And that, of course, was one reason he was such a tremendous teacher. As the generations of students who followed me into that study of his know, Eric could count the angels on any literary pinhead. And for Eric, all those writers were in the room with him as he paced around, talking to them, at them, for them. He loved to take pot shots at any bete noir of that particular moment, whether it was Julie Kristeva, pow, Mikhail Bakhtin and his version of Rabelais, pow, any received idea that he felt to be dull, pa, 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 he would shoot them out of the sky. It was exhilarating to be in his company, for he was an extraordinarily brilliant teacher. And this, of course, is his true legacy. A sometimes partial one, he could be unfair to those he excluded from his circle, and I'll always remember the shocked tones, and Eric was very seldom shocked, when he once told me that a student was doing a dissertation on Tolkien. But if he engaged with you, it was a life-transforming experience. For Eric, the study of English literature mattered in a heuristic way, in a way that constantly questioned one's own responses and assumptions, in a way that affirmed what it is to be alive and to process mute swirls of consciousness into words on the page. He had a passionate engagement compared to what he saw as the bland ministrations of much of the English literature industry. And he was impatient with the narrowness of their specialist vision. Eric was as happy discoursing on Lorca as on Amy Winehouse. Just as, after his conversion to Catholicism, he came to dislike the criticism of metropolitan literary papers with what he saw as their dull, modernist orthodoxy and lack of true moral compass. Eric was an academic, but he was never an academician. He never played the game of career advancement. He was a true scholar in the sense that all he wanted in life was a room in which to keep his books. The figure that inevitably comes to mind is that of Coleridge, to whom Eric was temperamentally similar. Coleridge, standing in his study at Greta Hall with its big windows, looking out at a vista of mountains and space in which all seemed possible, but nothing was quite within reach. The central image in Eric's Biographia Literaria would be of him pacing his study over Newcourt, listening to talking heads, chain smoking, chain drinking gin and tonics, engaging with his writers like a shaman summoning up spirit gods from the past, but never able to wrestle them to the floor, or indeed wanting to. For Eric, as his students knew, was suspicious of theory, suspicious of any critical conclusion that tied up a writer in a neat cardboard box and delivered it in gift wrapping to the reader. To use a theoretical term that he might not have approved of, now that he's no longer here, to give a despairing sideways glance at any solecism, that's all very well, Hugh, but when are we going to get to the original thinking here? Eric was suspicious of closure. And this is not closure for Eric, despite the cruel, cruel way he was taken from us. He lives on in the minds and hearts of those he taught. He was a mesmeric and powerful influence on many, as can be seen by all those who've gathered here. He was a truly Socratic presence. And he will also live on in his lectures, which Freya Johnson and the OUP have so commendably started to publish, which capture perfectly what she describes as the fast, sardonic, protesting, and exact tone of his public voice. There are apparently many more of these essays, and I suspect they will be his true published legacy, given he did not publish so much earlier. And how wonderful that the first volume of them came out while he was still alive. As we grow older, we collect the voices of those who passed inside our own heads. I will hear him in my mind until the day I die, cajoling, exhorting, and above all, questioning, which surely is the true role of a critic in a world so complacent in its own certainties. And I want to end with the words addressed to Ser Brunetto by Eric's beloved Dante. For a moment, I dreamed he was running on the green sward of Verona, where he could claim the green roll of cloth as his own, for he always seemed more like the one who wins than those who lose.
I feel touched and a bit flattered too to have been asked to speak briefly and give a reading in front of so many people who knew Eric much better than me, and I wasn't quite sure why I'd been asked. But maybe, as a former colleague from a long, long time ago, but somebody who lives still in the strange land of academic English and yet hasn't been in Cambridge for some 25 years, I can at least be a witness to Eric's really incredible influence and very unconventional, unusual influence in the world outside Cambridge. And I think it would have pleased him, but I'm not quite sure he ever quite realized how frequently, in my experience, not just in the world of academia and education, but in the wider literary world, amongst people in broadcasting or journalism, how frequently one comes upon somebody who speaks of having been taught by Eric, and whenever they do, of the extraordinary influence that it's had on them. And I can't think of any other example of somebody who so intensely lives on in the minds and imaginations of individuals whom he taught. I regarded Eric with admiration, sometimes exasperation, often trepidation. I first met him properly, I think, at a Cambridge English faculty examiner's dinner, where he was certainly the most drunk person in the room, definitely the most interesting person in the room, and by far and away the scariest person in the room. Slowly, I began to realize how extraordinarily interested in teaching he was. This, of course, was in an age before tuition fees, before phalanxes of academics, including myself, had learned loudly to proclaim how interested in teaching they were. And always, if I sent him somebody when I was a director of studies to supervise, he always would. I confess, I tried to choose the robust. Those who could speak fluent French, that was always something that went down well. And I was always hoping that he would select me in return. And one day he did. And I got a phone call, and he said that somebody was coming from Trinity College, no less, to see me to be supervised for a dissertation on Tristram Shandy, which was fantastic, because that was one thing I did know about. The rather earnest young man turned up for his first meeting with me, and fishing for compliments, I asked him whether the choice of me was his idea or whether Eric had perhaps recommended me. "Oh yes," he said, "Dr. Griffiths suggested you." As I puffed up, he told me, "Dr. Griffiths said that he had no interest in supervising me on this topic, but he was sure you'd be quite happy to do so." Well, that's it in a nutshell, really. I never did find out, though, what was wrong with Tristram Shandy. I've chosen as a reading, I confess, knowing Eric's relish for Muriel Spark, I flirted with a passage from The Prime of Miss Jean Brodie, but in the end, I chose something perhaps less playful, but something that actually had influenced me. In the printed voice of Victorian poetry, which has been spoken of already, there are some, not many, but some, I think, wonderful pages on Hardy's poetry. And I remember first reading them, and in that way that has already been evidenced by other speakers, being influenced really forevermore about the way, in the way that I read this poet and these poems. And Eric talking of this Hardy poem after a journey had described how it includes, as he says, feelings counter to the declarative surface of the poem. And I've found that in Hardy ever since. It's a mournful poem, a poem of mourning in that weird Hardy way. But it's also a poem which I read through Eric's explanation of it. After a journey. Here too I come to view a voiceless ghost. Whither, oh whither, will its whim now draw me? Up the cliff, down, till I'm lonely, lost, and the unseen water's ejaculations awe me. Where you will next be, there's no knowing, facing round about me everywhere, with your nut-coloured hair and grey eyes and rose flush coming and going. Yes, I have re-entered your olden haunts at last, through the years, through the dead scenes I have tracked you. What have you now found to say of our past, scanned across the dark space wherein I have lacked you? Summer gave us sweets, but autumn wrought division. Things were not lastly as firstly well with us twain, you tell. But all's closed now, despite time's derision. I see what you are doing. You are leading me on to the spots we knew when we haunted here together, the waterfall above which the mist bow shone at the then fair hour in the then fair weather, and the cave just under, with a voice still so hollow that it seems to call out to me from 40 years ago when you were all aglow and not the thin ghost that I now frailly follow. Ignorant of what there is flitting here to see, the waked birds preen and the seals flop lazily. Soon you will have, dear, to vanish from me, for the stars close their shutters and the dawn whitens hazily. Trust me, I mind not, though life lowers, the bringing me here. Nay, bring me here again. I am just the same as when our days were a joy and our paths threw flowers.
This is from Samuel Beckett's First Love, lines which I remember reading as perhaps, I remember Eric reading even, as perhaps others do here. I associate, rightly or wrongly, my marriage with the death of my father in time. That other links exist on other levels between these two affairs is not impossible. I have enough trouble as it is in trying to say what I think I know. I visited not so long ago my father's grave. That I do know, and noted the date of his death alone, for that of his birth had no interest for me on that particular day. I set out in the morning and was back by night, having lunched lightly in the graveyard. But some days later, wishing to know his age at death, I had to return to the grave to note the date of his birth. These two limiting dates I then jotted down on a piece of paper, which I now carry about with me. I am thus in a position to affirm that I must have been about 25 at the time of my marriage. For the date of my own birth, I repeat, my own birth, I have never forgotten. I never had to note it down. It remains graven in my memory, the year at least, in figures that life will not easily erase. The day itself comes back to me when I put my mind to it, and I often celebrate it after my fashion. I don't say each time it comes back, for it comes back too often, but often. Personally, I have no bone to pick with graveyards. I take the air there willingly, perhaps more willingly than elsewhere, when take the air I must. The smell of corpses distinctly perceptible under those of grass and hummus mingled, I do not find unpleasant, a trifle on the sweet side perhaps, a trifle heady, but how infinitely preferable to what the living emit, their feet, teeth, armpits, arses, sticky foreskins and frustrated ovules. And when my father's remains join in, however modestly, I can almost shed a tear. The living wash in vain perfume themselves, they stink. Yes, as a place for an outing, when out I must, leave me my graveyards and keep you to your public parks and beauty spots. My sandwich, my banana, tastes sweeter when I'm sitting on a tomb. And when the time comes to piss again, as it so often does, I have my pick. Or I wander, hands clasped behind my back, among the slabs, the flat, the leaning, and the upright, culling the inscriptions. Of these, I never weary. There are always three or four of such drollery that I have to hold on to the cross, or the steel, or the angel, so as not to fall. Mine I composed long ago, and I'm still pleased with it, tolerably pleased. My other writings are no sooner dry than they revolt me, but my epitaph still meets with my approval. There is little chance, unfortunately, of its ever being reared above the skull that conceived it, unless the state takes up the matter. But to be unearthed, I must first be found, and I greatly fear those gentlemen will have as much trouble finding me dead as alive. So I hasten to record it here and now, while there is yet time. Hereunder lies the above, who up below so hourly died that he lived on till now. The second and last, or rather latter line, limps a little perhaps, but that is no great matter. I'll be forgiven more than that when I'm forgotten.
There was a time when Eric Griffiths was only a name to me. So I asked Christopher Ricks what it might be like for me to have Eric as a colleague. It's a wonderful idea, Christopher promptly replied. He will be tonic for you, and you will be sedative for him. And so it was. So it was. In truth, it proved to be a little bit more complicated, but let that be. As for everyone else here today, the things to which Eric opened my eyes and ears were immeasurable. One example, he introduced me to the writings of Simone Weil, a thinker who puts you on the spot, peremptory, astringent, truly tonic. I shall simply read half a dozen of the apophthegms culled from her notebooks, the collection known in English under the title Gravity and Grace. One. In the intellectual order, the virtue of humility is nothing more nor less than the power of attention. Two. Unobtrusiveness, the infinitesimal character of pure good. Three, the attitude of looking and waiting is the attitude which corresponds with the beautiful. As long as one can go on conceiving, wishing, longing, the beautiful does not appear. That is why in all beauty we find contradiction, bitterness, and absence, which are irreducible. Four. The poet produces the beautiful by fixing his attention on something real. It is the same with the act of love. To know that this man who is hungry and thirsty really exists as much as I do, that is enough. The rest follows of itself. The authentic and pure values, truth, beauty, and goodness in the activity of a human being are the result of one and the same act. A certain application of the full attention to the object. Teaching should have no aim but to prepare, by training the attention, for the possibility of such an act. All the other advantages of instruction are without interest. Five. Only drama without movement is truly beautiful. Shakespeare's tragedies are second class, with the exception of Lear. Those of Racine, third class, except for Phèdre. Those of Corneille, of the nth class. Six. The destruction of Troy, the fall of the petals from fruit trees in blossom. To know that what is most precious is not rooted in existence, that is beautiful. Why? It projects the soul beyond time. The woman who wishes for a child white as snow and red as blood gets it, but she dies and the child is given over to a stepmother.
Thank you. So that concludes this part of the proceedings. We adjourn. You're very welcome to move a short distance across Great Court to tea and reminiscence, no doubt, in the Master's Lodge. Following that, as you will see from the card, for those with stamina, appetite, and enthusiasm, there are further increasingly informal entertainments, further readings, performances at three different locations in the college. If you have any, and the first one, the move to the Bowling Green, will take place about 4:15. If you want to keep an eye on either me or Ruth McKenzie, Ruth, why don't you stand up and show Ruth McKenzie, then we will lead the way. But for now, the Master's Lodge and tea.
Well, Music is supposed to be an international language. Walk into any shanty town, sing a B-flat, and people will flock around you, understanding what you mean. That's the story, anyway. An old story. Nowadays, there's a new version of that old story. It's called world music. The idea is you take a bunch of musicians from a variety of cultures. They get together and influence each other a lot. A bit of gamelan, shade of Afro rhythm, maybe some white soul. Now, of course, this could be dreadful. A sort of musical safari holiday, with the music no better than the flamenco that's dished out to tourists on the Costa del Sol. What makes the difference is when the songs really ask questions about the world, inquire about the many worlds we live in. And if they do that, then they can have a sense of harmony, which is more than just singing in thirds, and a sense of time, which is better than just counting one, two, three, four in a bar. One of the jolliest songs on the new album is Nothing But Flowers. It's about the paradise of the Green Party. Factories disappear, streams run with Perrier water, the trees return, white sugar becomes extinct, and the shopping malls are covered with flowers.
When I was wondering what to do this afternoon, Ruth, our impresario, suggested I do something in Russian, and that made perfect sense. I first met Eric as a student in 1985, when Stephen Heath, I was an undergraduate at Jesus, and Stephen Heath, who was here this afternoon, which was lovely, suggested that I go to Eric, well, in fact, I asked him if I could go to Eric to study for a paper called the Avant-Garde Paper in European Literature. And Eric taught me for that and no one else. He absolutely despised the paper and the whole conception of it. But we had tremendous fun working with French, English, and Russian. And from that time on, he consistently, with his wit and love, encouraged me in migration from English to Russian studies. And in all the work I've done since then, writing and teaching. So, as the song said, God only knows what I'd be. The engagement with foreign languages always animated our friendship. His boundless curiosity and delight in learning about the workings of languages he knew a little or a lot or not at all, and his relentless attention to the details of language are gifts that I feel are still alive in me. So when I was thinking about what to do today, I looked at a batch of old letters from Eric from the early 2000s when I was living in Moscow. And they were very happy letters, full of delight from Eric. And he was here and the cats were coming into his life. He was adding Lupin and Pearl to his entourage, along with Mona and Aberdeen, who were kittens that came from my family home. And they were full of fun and laughter and rude jokes about the cats. But an ongoing subject between us was, number one, his plan to come to visit me in Russia. He always wanted to see St. Petersburg, Moscow not so much. And his work on Dante in English. He was very interested in the engagement with Dante of Anna Akhmatova and Osip Mandelstam. And he wrote in his wonderful long introduction to Dante in English about Akhmatova's poem of 1936, Dante, which was dedicated to Osip Mandelstam, who was at that time in exile and would soon perish on his way to a gulag in Magadan. So at that time, the most flattering letter and affectionate letter I ever received from Eric was in response to, he asked me to give a literal translation of this poem, because he was suspicious of the translations he'd read. So all I did was give an absolutely literal, word-for-word translation of the Akhmatova poem Dante. And I got in reply an email subject heading, Interanimation. You, my child, you are simply the best. Capitals. That was the best answer I have ever received to a question in my life. No, seriously, take 10 gazillion brownie points. I am well pleased in you. So then it goes on for several paragraphs, asking me questions about grammatical genders, adjectives, ambiguities, whether Florence is he or she, genders in Russian, the differences between prepositions, the interrelationships, the syntactical ambiguities. And then he goes, but you know me, ever hopeful and occasionally prone to greed. So he thanks me, and then at the end he says, no, but seriously, I will send you the two versions of the page in which you so helpfully intervened. You will see that you've saved me from the folly of trusting in the translator in his final line. Why are translators so wicked? Why don't you and I do more translating? I'd love to translate, wouldn't you? Anyway, I don't particularly love translating, and we never did any translation together, and he never came to Russia. But I did translate last year a poem by Osip Mandelstam, whom Eric was always interested in, for my sister-in-law, the composer Lisa Ilyin, to set to music. And that is the wonderful poem Sleeplessness that Mandelstam wrote in Crimea in 1915, when he himself was engaging with a foreign language. He was trying to read Homer's Iliad in Greek. So, as my offering, well, I also want to say this poem has moved me in the last year because I translated it last summer. And the last time I saw Eric was a year ago, pretty much this weekend, at his 65th birthday party, the wonderful, luminous celebration of the publication of his book and his birthday in his little house on the edge of Northwest Cambridge. It was a most magical afternoon, and Eric was in his bed, and we were all gathered around his bedhead. And the lines and images in this poem about speech and silence and the noise in one's head and the final image of the sea rolling up to the bedhead have since then become connected in my mind with Eric. So I will read it, it's not very long, in my and Lisa Ilyin's English translation, and then in Russian. Sleeplessness. Homer. The sails tense. I have read the list of ships to the middle. This long train, this herd of cranes that once arose over Hellas. Like a fleet of cranes to strange frontiers, a divine spray on the heads of kings. Where are you sailing? If not for Helen, what is Troy alone to you, Achaean men? And the sea and Homer, all is moved by love. To whom shall I listen? And Homer falls silent now. And the Black Sea, declaiming, resounds and rolls towards the bedhead with a heavy growl. And Eric would be interested in the fact that all is moved by love. The verb moved in Russian is reflexive, so literally it means everything moves itself by love or through love. So here's my offering for Eric in Russian. Бессонница, гомер, тугие паруса. Я список кораблей прочел до середины. Сей длинный выводок, сей поезд журавлинный, что над Эладой когда-то поднялся. Сей журавлинный клин в чужие рубежи, на головах царей божественная пена. Куда плывете вы, когда бедней Елена? Что трое вам одна, ахейские мужи? И море, и Гомер, все движется любовью. Кого же слышит мне? И вот Гомер молчит. И черное море витийствуя шумит, и с тяжким грохотом подходит к изголовью. Thank you.
And so this is from Brian, who many of you may have known. If you don't know him, you might know his work. Thoroughly nice person, much nicer than me. In May 1980, as we were coming to the end of the first year reading English at Trinity, the rumors began to spread that our new director of studies was the most debauched man in Cambridge. As it turned out, nothing could have prepared us for Eric Griffiths in the flesh. He was dazzling in body, mind, and speech, and he was absolutely one of a kind. In fact, for the first couple of years, Eric took care not to be superlatively debauched. He was a little bit scared of Trinity, perhaps even of us, if you can believe that. The fable was that he had done a couple of things at Christ's which were a bit too much, and he really didn't want to be kicked out of Trinity. There was a photo on the wall at Eric's wake in which he is walking across the lawn at Neville's Court, where he lived briefly before he moved to M3 New Court, which captured perfectly his sheer glee at that time. Look at me. Trinity, for him, was the College of Wittgenstein and Piero Sraffa, and he was in awe of the institution and of himself for being a part of it. Within a little while, he recovered from that. Stopped being surprised that he was a fellow of Trinity, and started being surprised that everyone else was. He never really got over his disappointment at how ordinary most fellows of Trinity were. For the next few years, he lost any inhibitions. He took risks with himself in everything, and for a while it looked as if he was saying to the world, "How far do you think I can go?" In 1998, two things happened which broke Eric's career in two. When Jeremy Moole died, he lost the colleague whom he loved the most, who understood him, and was clever enough, more or less, to keep up with him. Eric missed Jeremy more than he was ever capable of saying. I was with Eric much of the day at the funeral, and we talked a long time in his room. I was shocked at the viperous atmosphere in the college, in which none of the people in English were talking to any of the others. Things were falling apart for Eric because of the incident that was in all over the newspapers. He gave his own account, which I found absolutely believable. Incidentally, I did too. Quite apart from the fact that although Eric had many faults, mendacity was quite unnatural to him. Rather, he couldn't help telling the truth. I told him that, and then added that in any case, he had done much more sackable things which nobody had ever cared about. Eric looked at me for a moment and then burst out laughing, and then said with a hint of pride, "I know exactly." As everyone recalls, Eric retreated into himself from that time onwards. Fellows of the college, when I was visiting, would say that they hadn't seen him for months and would refer to him in slightly hushed tones as an enfant terrible, comparing him with Norman Stone. Stone, too, had a wicked tongue and delighted in being acidulous at others' expense. And he was also known for being an inspiring but also outrageous tutor at Trinity. As it happens, Richard Evans just recently wrote the Guardian obituary of Stone, what you might call the longest assassination note in history. In it, he finishes by saying that Stone was a terrible historian, and then quoting Sir Edward Heath on Stone, many parents of Oxbridge students must be both horrified and disgusted that the higher education of our children should rest in the hands of such a man. However much Eric would have loved that to be said of him, he was the antithesis of Stone. Even his worst enemies, and he had a lot of them, would not deny that he was a brilliant literary critic. And while Stone used put-downs to flatter himself and deflect the truth, Eric used his wit to raise the stakes of truth, and if anything, to expose himself to greater scrutiny. There is no doubt that he broke the boundaries of behavior towards his students. He got too close to us. He told us too much. And he had an overpowering weakness for crushing sarcasm. I was one of the lucky ones, since he thought my mind was okay and he liked me. But I have not often felt such pure terror as standing outside the outer door to M3, left slightly ajar on purpose, as Eric rasped out that familiar arch Mephistophelian, "Come in," from high upstairs. For years, I made myself desperate for his praise, knowing that the more I wanted it, the less he would feel inclined to give it. Between them, Geoffrey Hill and Eric slowed down my writing career by about 10 years each. I could not bear to produce a sentence they would dislike. Of course, you can immediately turn that into a quality. Eric taught intense self-criticism, if you were ready to learn it from him. And it was matched by the criticism he turned on himself. Almost as famous as the lash of his tongue and the endless flow of his speech was the endless wait for his own book. He could not bear to produce a sentence that he disliked. In some ways, though, this was to mistake the nature of his gift. Everybody thought of Eric as a great writer who did not write. But the thing that was absolutely stupendous about Eric was his power as a reader. For most people, reading looks like the easy bit, as easy as breathing. However, good reading is a much more difficult skill than good writing, and perhaps more socially useful. During his legendary poetry classes, or even during a supervision, Eric the reader was in full flow. His technical skill, imaginative play, his sheer gift for seeing things no one can see for themselves, but which seemed obvious when he said them, was sensational. It was certainly the most exciting thing that happened to me in my undergraduate career. When Eric was writing, I think he tried to capture the intuitive understanding that he felt so readily as a reader. But it is not the same thing. Sometimes he seemed to be trying too hard, or mistaking winning an argument in person with haranguing a reader to death in print. Of course, his main subject as a critic through all his work was the relationship between speech and writing. He insisted that good writing was like a good conversation. But was he kidding himself? Most great writers are terrible at table talk. I am so grateful to Freya for producing, if not critical, and for bringing Eric back to public attention. But the truth is that it is still on the shelf near my desk, almost unopened. I can't quite bear to hear that inimitable voice again, but I also fear that it isn't his voice in any case, since his gift was for living speech. Even though the Daily Mail affair hurt Eric greatly, much more than his supposed victim, and reduced his influence as a tutor and a don, it may have made him a better teacher. Terrific students of his in later years, like Oliver Morgan and Samir Rahim, talk of him as just as outrageous, but more generous. People who thought him cruel misunderstood him. He wanted to be given love more than anything, but he had no desire to be ordinarily lovable or vulnerable. He took that as a kind of deceit, and we have all surely suffered more from Cambridge hypocrisy than from Eric's malevolent honesty. In later years, while never exactly easy company, Eric found a way of sharing his feelings. I recall a fantastic time at a symposium in Christ's when he sedulously showed me Milton's tree, or when I was external examiner for part two of the Tripos and he was chair of examiners. It was hilarious to watch him refereeing the rules he had always been most adept at breaking. And of course, I cannot forget being there by chance the week that he had the terrifying stroke. And I should add, rather than referring to myself horribly in the third person, that I took him into Addenbrooke's to see Eric. And going on with Brian, he says, covering my ineptitude, I mumbled about how I was writing a paper on the origins of the feminine rhyme. Unable to articulate a single word, Eric came alive, gesturing to me to explain. Somehow, just with his eyes and his grimace of disdain, he conveyed to me that everything I was saying was wrong. He wanted me to say the name of a poet, and I kept saying the wrong one until I twigged and choked. Chaucer. I was in tears, but Eric just sighed with satisfaction, as to say, finally you got something right. Somewhere in the excruciating pain and horror of a human being so fine cut down, he was still teaching me to do better, still telling me off while still loving me, and still showing me that unbelievable gift for reading.
Hello, I chose this poem, William Empson's Chinese Ballad, partly remembering another memorial occasion. It was held in Cambridge in 1985 for Empson, and his widow Hetta read the poem. Eric and I were both there and talked afterwards about the poem and her reading. Empson was one of many writers I read, I think lots of us probably read, under Eric's direction. He did have a directive side, even before he became a director of studies, but more than any directing, we read things because of how appealing he made the writers he took up with. You didn't want to miss out on the pleasure, interest, importance, fun he'd shown them to offer. So Eric was an admirer of Empson and invited him to Cambridge. And one of his opening gambits was, when did you first become interested in fairies? This was at once blameless and rude. Blameless because Empson was working on fairies in the Midsummer Night's Dream. Rude because of the unspoken hint that he was saying, you ridiculous old queen. It was one of the ways Eric went too far, as was suggested, that he had an urge to be rude to people he liked and admired, to show he wasn't a lackey. Anyway, he'd quite probably move on and go off them quite soon. On the other hand, he'd also be rude to people he didn't like or admire, so it was no guarantee he was in receipt of this. Empson said that he was attracted by the notion of a hearty indifference to one's own and other people's feelings when a fragment of the truth is in question. I think Eric's best rudeness was part of that commitment to truth-telling. His writing and teaching carried on an Empsonian tradition. He taught me in the late 70s and early 80s, which I think was one of his best and happiest times as a teacher. There was the extraordinary intellect, the brio of his teaching, the way that what he called Empson's exquisite gift for paraphrase was reborn in Eric, I think, as a gift for parody, of an inimical kind of comic type. He was incredibly funny, as most of us will remember. He was marked by decision and courage, and he was never parochial or narrow. I was struck reading, if not critical, when it came out last year by that terrific range that Eric showed with the essays on Racine and Kafka, Dante, Primo Levi, a counterpart in a way of Empson on Chinese culture. And had Eric's health lasted, I hope he would have written a book on Romanesque architecture that he was planning to do. To all of these, he added a social generosity, which, as you've heard, I abused by enjoying Bruce Springsteen and beating him at poker, and a mission for teaching that were all his own. And one other thing on Empson. I asked Eric last summer about how about another book of your uncollected writings? Who would you like to have in there? And he said Empson, Dryden, Beckett, Christina Rossetti. Among others, I think, but I hope someone will pick up that baton as well. So in the Chinese ballad poem, the setting is two lovers parting when one of them is going back to war, and the young woman is the main speaker. After Hetta Empson read it, Eric and I talked about it, and he especially liked lines 5 to 6, 8 and 24. That would work better with PowerPoint, but you'll have to make do with the hollyhocks. Sorry, I'm being a bit dry. This is the Chinese ballad. Now he has seen the girl, Xiang Xiang, now back to the guerrilla band, and she goes with him down the vale and pauses at the strand. The mud is yellow, deep and thick, and their feet stick where the stream turns. Make me two models out of this that clutches as it yearns. Make one of me and one of you, and both shall be alive. Were there no magic in the dolls, the children could not thrive. When you have made them, smashed them back, they yet shall live again. Again make dolls of you and me, but mix them grain by grain. So your flesh shall be part of mine, and part of mine be yours. Brother and sister we shall be, whose unity endures. Always the sister doll will cry, made in these careful ways, cry on and on, come back to me, come back in a few days.
I'm very grateful to Ruth for having the opportunity to read this poem. It technically marks the start of my relationship with Eric, in that it was the poem that he set for my Cambridge interview, ensuring that I will never again read it without hearing his version of it on the piano, which he also played to me. His mission during my interview was primarily to establish whether I had any real interest in English literature, or just thought it might be a jolly way to spend 3 years while singing in an excellent choir. Given I spent most of the following 2 days in tears, and yet he still let me in, I must have said something not completely stupid somewhere, though I'm blowed if I can remember what it was. He supervised two of my undergraduate dissertations, not so gently suggesting that Beckett might prove a more interesting topic than Yeats, and Joyce, which I loved greatly. But again, I've appreciated so many of the speakers today who've talked about his commitment to originality of thought and arriving at that stage of being able to form things for yourself rather than just regurgitating what the critics said. And I remember during one stage of composing the dissertation that I'd read an American feminist critic on the particular passage of Ulysses I was working on, who was very, very harsh on the heroine for her interest in silk stockings. And I'd swallowed this whole and spat it all out again in my next supervision. And Eric wrote acidly on the side of my page, "Oh yes, and I suppose no good Catholic lady ever wore nail polish." Another theme's been kindness. For reasons I'm completely unable to understand, he had great belief in my potential. He was terribly disappointed when I joined the London Review of Books. He said to me after Mass, "I hope you sup with a long spoon." Like most of Herbert, this seems on the surface like a very simple, tidy poem, yet there's so much in it. There's God in the small things and the everyday, and the ways in which a task done well and with commitment is transfigured, becoming a window onto the visionary, and the universality of grace and mercy open to everyone, however mean. The elixir. Teach me, my God and King, in all things thee to see, and what I do in anything to do it as for thee. Not rudely as a beast to run into an action, but still to make thee prepossessed and give it his perfection. A man that looks on glass, on it may stay his eye, or if he pleaseth, through it pass, and then the heaven espy. All may of thee partake. Nothing can be so mean which with his tincture, for thy sake, will not grow bright and clean. A servant with this clause makes drudgery divine. Who sweeps a room, as for thy laws, makes that and the action fine. This is the famous stone that turneth all to gold. For that which God doth touch and own cannot for less be told.
Eric taught me as an undergraduate, as many here, and I taught with him for 10 years in Trinity, from the difficult year 1999 until 2010, when I left to become a parish priest full time. I don't know if he liked this poem. I suspect he probably wouldn't very much, but it makes me think of him. Joseph, Mary, pray for those misled by moonlight and the rose, for all in our perplexity. Lovers who hear a distant bell that tolls from somewhere in their head across the valley of their dream. All those who love excessively, foot or thigh or arm or face, pursue a louche and fatuous fire and stumble into hell. Yet, what can such foreboding seem but intellectual talk, so long as bodies walk an earth where time and space turn heaven to a finite bed and love into desire? Pray for us, enchanted with the green bohemia of that myth, where knowledge of the flesh can take the guilt of being born away. Simultaneous passions make one eternal chastity. Pray for us, romantics. Pray.
So I, again, am a deeply indebted former student of Eric's. I think I was in Clare College at the time, and Eric arrived in Trinity. And I heard through a friend that I had to attend the lecture of their new director of studies. And I went to a lecture on Wordsworth and sympathy. And I just decided that I had to be taught by this man who had played so wonderfully and so deeply with the meaning of this word and had sort of opened it up and opened up literature all within the space of 55 minutes. And I knocked on his door in Neville's Court and asked if he would supervise me. And for some reason he said yes. And I was then fortunate enough to study with Eric for the next 2 years. He did once say that I was ineducable. I think that there possibly is some truth in that. But I took everything to heart. And I'm very grateful indeed to Freya for having published these lectures. And I am going to read from the end of his wonderful lecture, Beasts, just because to me it exemplifies the way that Eric's mind worked. It articulates his essential approach. And there are three pieces of reading, which is so much the way he taught. So I would then carry away anything he suggested I read and try and find something there that was mine. So I'm just going to read the last bit of this wonderful lecture, Beasts. Remembering J.L. Austin's philosophically grounded plea for a keener attention to a greater variety of examples, it will, I hope, be clear that it is not in a spirit of anti-intellectualism or anti-theory that I offer no formulation of the essence of comedy. Thinking about comedy does have to submit to the test and the pleasure of examples, and has to deny itself the relaxations of the big idea. So I end not with a conclusion, but with three exemplary remarks about laughter which are worth keeping in mind and taking to heart. Beckett, this is from Molloy, a conversation between a priest and one of his flock. I can't do accents, so I'm not going to try. I told him how worried I was about my hens, particularly my grey hen, which would neither brood nor lay, and for the past month and more had done nothing but sit with her arse in the dust from morning to night. Like Joe, ha ha, he said. I too said, ha ha. What a joy it is to laugh from time to time, he said. Is it not? I said. It is peculiar to man, he said. So I have noticed, I said. A brief silence ensued. What do you feed her on? He said. Corn chiefly, I said. Cooked or raw, he said. Both, I said. I added that she ate nothing more. Nothing, he cried. Next to nothing, I said. Animals never laugh, he said. It takes us to find that funny, I said. What? He said. It takes us to find that funny, I said loudly. He mused. Christ never laughed either, he said, so far as we know. He looked at me. Can you wonder? I said. There it is, he said. He smiled sadly. Newman on the devil. Yes, he is a master who allows himself to be served without trembling. It is his very art to lead men to be at ease with him, to think lightly of him and to trifle with him. He will submit to their ridicule, take, as it were, their blows, and pretend to be their slave that he may ensnare them. He has no dignity to maintain, and he waits his time when his malice will be gratified. So it has ever been all over the earth. Among all nations, it has been his aim to make men laugh at him. Going to and fro upon the earth and walking up and down in it, hearing and rejoicing in that light, perpetual talk about him, which is his worship. The Gospel according to St. Luke. And he lifted up his eyes on his disciples and said, "Blessed be ye poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are ye that hunger now, for ye shall be filled. Blessed are ye that weep now, for ye shall laugh." Thank you.
Jolene, 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 I'm begging of you, please don't hit my man. Jolene, 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 please don't take him just because you
lectures. I was never one of his students, and in fact I don't think I ever heard him speak in any public capacity at all. The times I heard him speak were almost always around a table covered with food and drink. But I was a friend of Eric's through my husband, who was the writer and art critic Tom Lubbock. Tom died in January 2011, which was very close around the time when Eric was taken ill. Tom was never a student of Eric's either. But Tom and Eric were very good friends, and they remain so. And when I was thinking about what I could contribute to this event in Eric's honour, I was looking through some old emails. And my attention was drawn to an email that Eric sent to Tom in May 2010, when Tom was very much dying. The subject heading was RIP1. Turns out this is the title of a lecture called Regular Iambic Pentameter 1. And I'm going to read you the first section of RIP 1. Some of you might remember being in the room and hearing it. Some of you might have made notes on it. And what I really love about it, apart from the fantastic content, is that it is, of course, Eric's speaking voice written down. And you'll have to remember what that sounded like. I should say that in the email, Eric described RIP 1 as a workaday lecture. So this is Eric Griffiths, RIP 1. I'm just going to read you the first section. Someone in pursuit of a slogan once asked T.S. Eliot, "What's the function of poetry in the modern world?" And Eliot replied, "Takes up less space." He didn't opt for, explains the origins of thunder, singing the loves of gods and men, feigning notable images of virtue, or any of the many other previously popular mission statements for poetry. In Eliot's reply, poetry figures as something modest, shy even, particular and frail. As the reply was itself so concise, his words may have been not only an answer to a journalistic question, but an example of space-saving poetry. Though the remark folds away into no room at all, it carries a bulky presupposition. It thinks of poetry as words on a page, fewer words on fewer pages, as contrasted with mighty shelf fillers, such as Churchill's four-volume History of the English-Speaking Peoples, or his six-volume The Second World War. Eliot was, compared to Churchill, not a voluminous writer, but he still thinks of poetry as, first of all, something written. This seems a safe thing to take for granted, yet creates problems when it comes to describing the relation of oral to graphic poetry. Homer composes songs long before they were written down. Large bodies of folk poetry survive, which were born on the air, and are tricky to notate onto a page. Antiphonal chanting, skipping rhymes, poems made to be sung while dancing, these are all kinds of poetry. And there is no reason to think of them as somehow secondary to a poetry where it sits quietly in the corner of a page, taking up no more space than a weeping fig. How fundamental this matter is comes out when you realize it affects even so basic a notion as a line of verse. On the one hand, the poetry is written in lines, seems an essential truth to Tomaszewski, and I quote, "This breaking down the language of poetry into lines, into units of similar phonic energy, even in extreme cases of identical weights, is clearly the distinctive feature of poetic language. These lines of verse, or to introduce a new term, these equipotent discursive units, give us, as they follow one another, the impression of an organized repetition of sequences which resemble each other in sound." And that's from Boris Tomaszewski on verse, 1927. And this line is followed by some recent theory, as for instance, by Giorgio Agamben in his celebrated essay from 1995, The End of the Poem, and I quote, "The possibility of enjambement constitutes the only criterion for distinguishing poetry from prose." And of course, lineation is a necessary condition of enjambement. But on the other hand, anyone who's ever tried to write out the lyrics of, say, an Amy Winehouse song knows that the phrases seem to sway, now this way and now that. They can't readily be made to walk down straight lines, more or less uniform to the eye. Poems certainly have distinctive units of phonic energy, but whether lines are identical with those units is another matter. And the trouble with Amy Winehouse's flexuous phrasing is not confined to her. It's a sign of a broader condition, which Derek Attridge acutely identifies when talking about four beat verse, such as "Starlight, star bright, first star I see tonight." I quote, "The line is a somewhat arbitrary feature in this very regular type of verse, since it is only one of a number of simultaneously effective levels. Line junctures do correspond to important metrical divisions, but these are not the only metrical divisions." You can see the truth of this by reflecting on the fact that poems written in this measure can be written out in several different lineations
without the drastic effects that relineation would have on, for example, the love song of J. Alfred Prufrock. One of the signs that Eliot's poem is not really a song is just the importance to it of its lineation. By the way, Attridge's 1995 Poetic Rhythm is the best introduction I know to the practicalities of listening to verse rhythm. It is not the same book as his earlier Rhythms of English Poetry, also good but not so snappy. Another remarkable poet of the last century, Ossip Mandelstam, came at poetry from a different angle, a different dimension, in fact. When he thought of it not as occupying more or less space, but as operating in time. And I quote, "Any given word is a bundle, and meaning sticks out of it in various directions, not aspiring toward any single official point. In pronouncing the word sun, we are, as it were, undertaking an enormous journey to which we are so accustomed that we travel in our sleep. What distinguishes poetry from unreflective speech is that it rouses us and shakes us into wakefulness in the middle of a word. Then it turns out that the word is much longer than we thought, and we remember that to speak means to be forever on the road." That's from Ossip Mandelstam, Conversation About Dante. Here, the distinctive thing about poetry is not that it takes up less space, but that it takes more time. It slows our chatter. Both those who are keen to big poetry up and those who want to cry it down have spent, it seems to me, too much time on what differentiates poetry from other things which people do with words, and too little on the more numerous and more important things it has in common with other kinds of linguistic conduct. Just as Eliot's quip embodied the space saving it described, and so might be thought of as itself a poem, so Mandelstam's prose reflections on the word sun freeze frame our dealings with that word and alert us to it, as he says poems do. It's almost as if this passage of prose were itself a poem. It does what he says is a poem's work. Mandelstam's linguistic shaking and waking is not something only poetry can do, nor something which poetry always does, but his searching remarks are no less searching for that. We needn't think of Eliot's emphasis as simply counter to Mandelstam's approach. We can combine their sayings. Poetry takes up less space, blackens fewer pages, because it takes more time. It consumes time to create it. You have to travel long distances into words, and also to read it. You have to give it time to sink in, to let it tell the story of its travels. These are lectures about poems, rather than poems themselves. But in at least one respect, the first two items in the series will behave as Mandelstam says a poem does, in taking time to show that some words are much longer than we thought. This week I'm dwelling on regular, and next week on iambic pentameter. They are not as beautiful words as sun, and put together as regular iambic pentameter, they do not, unlike sun, name a real object, but a mirage with a complex history. I'll be spending a lot of time on the history of regular iambic pentameter, trying in effect to show that this history is much shorter than we were taught at school. People have not been writing iambic pentameters since the time of Chaucer, but only since, roughly speaking, the 18th century. And even then, not nearly as often as you might suppose. In most of your lectures, there will be more of your actual poetry than in today's offering. Throughout, there will be a lot about the history of English outside as well as inside poetry, because it is one of my main points that the schoolroom account of the English poetic tradition, an unbroken rolling down the centuries of masterpieces in iambic pentameter, falsifies the fits and starts of poetry, because it ignores the way that language has changed. The lectures have been scheduled to take place at noon, so that they can, if necessary, go on over the usual hour. Please don't feel you have to stay to the end.
I think, given everybody who's here today, I'm one of Eric's last students. I came to Cambridge in 2007, and prior to coming up, I'd spent a fleeting moment in the army, and I felt myself very much above and beyond the sort of petty intricacies of looking at books and seeing what they might mean. I didn't enjoy Cambridge in my first term, and the thing that really brought me, dragged me into the study of literature was Eric. I remember being daunted by the prospect of the first classes that we had here with Eric, which were classes on Troilus and Cressida, which was our Shakespeare text for part one. And I remember so vividly our first class in Trinity in the second term as the light was slowly falling and being utterly electrified by how he was able to play with words and meaning and the performative elements of what it was that we were studying and why it was that we were studying it. And as I came to be taught by him myself, I learned Italian broadly and mainly in order to please him, and then studied Dante and Levi with him. And in one supervision, we studied a moment in Primo Levi, who is an Auschwitz survivor, Holocaust survivor, a moment where Levi in Auschwitz remembers the rhythms and the meanings of Dante, which he had been forced to learn as a child in Turin. And he remembers in a moment of comparative freedom, Ulysses setting out in Canto 26 of the Inferno. And it was the most invigorating, empowering moment for me to think, maybe there is, if Levi could rely on Dante in Auschwitz, there might be more to literature than I've previously given it credit for. By the end of my time here, I was everything. I did every single paper with Eric. Every supervision I had was with Eric, apart from an American paper at the end, which consequently I totally bombed. I would have these roaringly drunken supervisions with him, and watching him just now on the TV is such a powerful reminder of what it was like to speak to him, what it was like to be in his company, where he seems to be saying 57 things at the same time. You're never quite sure what it is that he means, but you want to go along with it, and you are craving for his acceptance and his satisfaction. I always felt I disappointed him, and as time went on, you feel the increasing pressure of having pleased him a few times, so you know that you're just about to pop the bubble the next time you go in. I remember we heard earlier of disappointing him through a distressing heterosexuality. I very strongly felt that towards the end, and as my literary powers failed me, I often wondered whether a brief sojourn into homosexuality might bring him back to the fold. I didn't, hasn't I? The last time I saw Eric before he was sick, we walked around. We walked around the city of London, where he was preparing a lecture he was going to make in France about memory and the splicing of memory together with itself. And we walked around, very fittingly for here, we walked around the Wren churches, of which there are so many in the city. And he was trying to work out how it was that these perfectly formed Wren churches are spliced in with these sort of towering cityscapes of the biggest financial center in the world. I was trying to raise some money in the city at the time, and we had a fabulously drunken lunch afterwards in Spitalfields, where he was picking apart every element of the city and all that dwelt within it. And it was, as always, it always was with Eric, a new and shocking valuation of all we have been. With that quotation in mind of Eliot, I thought it was fitting to read something by Eliot because of how much Eric owed to him and how much I learned from Eric of him. So I'm going to read the last section of Ash Wednesday. Actually, with Eric in mind, that sounds very neat to say that I quote Eliot and I read Eliot. It's actually a lie. I actually intended to read In Memoriam, but Simon Russell Beale stole that from me, and you can't really begrudge him that. Although he didn't in the end, so I could have done. Anyway. Ash Wednesday, section 6. Although I do not hope to turn again, although I do not hope to turn, wavering between the profit and the loss, in this brief transit where the dream crossed twilight between birth and dying, bless me, Father, though I do not wish to wish these things, in the wide window toward the granite shore, the white sails still fly seaward, seaward flying, unbroken wings. And the lost heart stiffens and rejoices, and the lost lilac and the lost sea voices, and the weak spirit quickens to rebel, for the bent golden rod and the lost sea smell quickens to recover the cry of quail and the whirling plover, and the blind eye creates the empty forms between the ivory gates. And smell renews the salt savour of the sandy earth. This is the time of tension between dying and birth, the place of solitude where three dreams cross between blue rocks, that when the voices shaken from the yew tree drift away, let the other yew be shaken and reply. Blessed sister, holy mother, spirit of the fountain, spirit of the garden, suffer us not to mock ourselves with falsehood. Teach us to care and not to care. Teach us to sit still, even among these rocks, our peace in His will. And even among these rocks, sister, mother, and spirit of the river, spirit of the sea, suffer me not to be separated. And let my cry come unto thee. Thank you.
Well, Rocco's from the last generation of students. We were from the first for whom Eric really threw things open, the gates of feeling. But Eric's own dramatic career had only just ended with a production, a very hippified production of Alice in Wonderland, in which he played the Dormouse against Nick Powell's Wildian Mad Hatter. And my own acquaintance with Eric, my own affairs with Eric, started with him running the makeup on our great friend Kevin Jackson's production, illegal production, of the radio play All That Fall in the Old Reader at Pembroke College, in which Eric was deeply involved, and it was Kevin, with his deep feeling, his thorough knowledge of Beckett, who really stimulated Eric's in pleasure in Beckett. I think I want to give Kevin credit for that. Well, a short introduction to a short extract to a play that Eric hammed up immensely. Endgame.
Wait, is it not yet time for my painkiller?
No!
Wait! How are your eyes?
Bad.
But you can see.
All I want.
How are your legs?
Bad.
But you can walk.
I come and go.
In my house. One day you'll be blind like me. You'll be sitting there, a speck in the void, in the dark, forever, like me. One day you'll say to yourself, I'm tired, I'll sit down. And you'll go and sit down. Then you'll say, I'm hungry. I'll get up and get something to eat. But you won't get up. You'll say, I shouldn't have sat down. But since I have, I'll sit on a little longer. Then I'll get up and get something to eat. But you won't get up. And you won't get anything to eat. You'll look at the wall a while. Then you'll say, I'll close my eyes. Perhaps have a little sleep. After that, I'll feel better. And you'll close them. and when you open them again, there'll be no wall anymore. Infinite emptiness will be all around you. All the resurrected dead of all the ages wouldn't fill it. And there you'll be, like a little bit of grit in the middle of the step. Yes, one day you'll know what it is. You'll be like me, except that you won't have anyone with you, because you won't have had pity on anyone, and because there won't be anyone left to have pity on.
It's not certain. And there's one thing you forget. I can't sit down.
Well, you'll lie down then, what the hell, or you'll come to a standstill. Simply stop and stand still the way you are now. One day you'll say, I'm tired, I'll stop. What does the attitude matter?
So, you all want me to leave you?
Naturally.
Then I'll leave you.
You can't leave us.
Then I shan't leave you.
Why don't you finish us? I'll tell you the combination of the larder if you promise to finish me.
I couldn't finish you.
Then you shan't finish me.
And I'll leave you. I have things to do.
Do you remember when you came here?
No, too small, you told me.
Do you remember your father?
Same answer. You've asked me these questions millions of times.
I love the old questions. Ah, the old questions, the old answers, there's nothing like them. I was a father to you.
Yes. Yeah. You were that to me?
My house, a home for you.
Yes, yeah. This was that for me.
But for me, no father. But for Ham, no home.
I'll leave you.
Did you ever think of one thing?
Never!
That here we're down in a hole. But beyond the hills, eh? Perhaps it's still green, eh? Flora, Pomona, Ceres. Perhaps you won't need to go very far.
I can't go very far. I'll leave you.
Is my dog ready?
He lacks a leg.
Is he silky?
He's a kind of Pomeranian.
Go and get him.
He lacks a leg.
Go and get him. We're getting on.
Your dogs are here.
He's white, isn't he?
Nearly.
What do you mean, nearly? Is he white or isn't he?
He isn't.
You've forgotten the sex.
But he isn't finished. The sex goes on at the end.
You haven't put on his ribbons.
But he isn't finished, I tell you. First you finish your dog, and then you put on his ribbon.
Can he stand?
I don't know.
Try. Well?
Wait!
Well?
He's standing.
Where? Where is he?
There.
Is he gazing at me?
Yes.
As if he were asking me to take him for a walk?
If you like.
Or as if he were begging me for a bone? Leave him like that, standing there, imploring me.
I'll leave you.
Claude?
Yes?
Do you not think this has gone on long enough?
Yes! What?
This thing.
I've always thought so. You not?
Then it's a day like any other day.
As long as it lasts. All life long, the same inanities.
I can't leave you.
I know, and you can't follow me.
If you leave me, how shall I know?
Well, you simply whistle me, and if I don't come running, it means I left you.
You won't come and kiss me goodbye?
No, I shouldn't think so.
But you might be merely dead in your kitchen.
The result would be the same.
Yes, but how would I know if you were merely dead in your kitchen?
Well, sooner or later, I'd start to stink.
You stink already. The whole place stinks of corpses.
The whole universe.
To hell with the universe. Think of something.
What?
An idea. Have an idea. A bright idea.
Ah, good. Pains in my legs. It's unbelievable. Soon I won't be able to think anymore.
You won't be able to leave me. What are you doing?
Having an idea!
What a brain. Well?
Wait. Yes. Yes! I have it! I set the alarm!
This is perhaps not one of my bright days, but frankly...
You whistle me, I don't come. The alarm rings, I'm gone. It doesn't ring, I'm dead!
Is it working? The alarm, is it working?
Why wouldn't it be working?
Because it's worked too much.
But it's hardly worked at all.
Then because it's worked too little.
I'll go and see.
Longer. I just thought it would be good to end with Eric's own voices and his own close reading. Under the epic room up there, which sort of terrified so many when we were climbing those sort of the steep stairs. But it's also the arena for so extraordinary mental gymnastics as well as. And actually, one of the things is up there that. That so many of us learn how to read. Eric took Christopher Rix's genius for close reading and carried it forwards and attempted what he would say is a kind of modest way, but it wasn't as a spectacular way, to become a Griffithsian form of close reading. And I think that a couple of things that are sort of characteristic of those of that is like, firstly, the boldness of his sense of comedy, which I think he drew from Christopher Rix's sense of Beckett, in many ways, and the other side was his big huge heart. It was like the reading and his close readings often go to the heart. Of the lines as sort of emotional and complex events. So just to give you a sense of those two, firstly, a little extract from Dryden's Past, which is a talk he gave at the British Academy in 1992. Dryden was expert at making his poems sound as if they inhabited two worlds at the same time. Such double domicile is a condition of all mock heroic writing and follows from the historical parallels between two ages, which he drew in works like Absalom and Achitophel. His draftsmanship in such parallelism was intricate. Consider the debate about why it was that Absalom was the most beautiful of David's sons. And this is Dryden. Whether inspired by some diviner lust, his father got him with a greater gust, or that his conscious destiny made way by manly beauty to imperial sway. The two couplets offer slyly, Eric says, slyly competing explanations of Absalom's good looks, and they are modulated in sound so that the first sounds earthier, more brass tacky, while the, taxi. While the second conducts itself more as beseems an epic, which this poem is slightly pretending to be. The first couplet is from the world of Gloucester sniggering about Edgar's conception. We might imagine it as something a yokel who supported Absalom Monmouth might have said. The next lines, in the comparatively refined style of the modern heroic, might rather be imagined as issued by the Duke of Monmouth's press office. The wonderful disparity between the two couplets arise from the bouncily alliterative, his father got him with a greater gust. A heartiness which is sedulously removed from the polish of what follows. Gust is especially rich, meaning relish, but also conveying that the earth moved for David at this particular copulation, and also because of the sense of gush which gust had in Dryden's English, indelicately hinting that he may have ejaculated more copiously for this son than for the others. All such thoughts are banished from the pastiche Virgilianism of all that his conscious destiny made sway. The two styles together compose a perfect emblem for the semi-civilized state of England at that time. We might say, were it not that the historical parallels Dryden has drawn and the fact that his joke is still alive and kicking, should rather incline us to say, given our experience of after times, that the passage images a state in which we are still living. That's like high gusto, superb brio, fantastic close reading of, let's say, the comic, the kind. I'll sort of move over to his readings of Tennyson's to show how the close readings are also a thing of the heart for him. And he's thinking about Tennyson and reticence, and we can begin to see the workings of that reticence in an early masterpiece to J.S. Reading Tennyson's poem. I will not say God's ordinance of death is blown in every wind. For that is not a common chance that takes away a noble mind. His memory long will live alone in all our hearts as mournful light that broods above the fallen sun and dwells in heaven half the night. Vain solace. Memory standing near cast down her eyes, and in her throat her voice seemed distant, and a tear dropped on the letters as I wrote. I will not say is not only an instance of the rhetorical figure of apophasis, a kind of irony, a refusal to speak. For Tennyson does not nevertheless speak and tell all here, but writes to Spedding rather than speaking to him. This poem exists primarily in its written form. Any vocalization, such as mine, would create problems of tone, which the silent writing indicates but does not suffer from. Consider how reading this poem aloud you would distinguish God's ordinance of death is blown in every wind from the other lines I have quoted. If you are in fact saying all the lines, then these words have to be given a distinct tone to show that they are especially not said by the poet, though many others say such things. Such a tone would tend to emphasize the proverbial quality of these words. And then Eric compares Gertrude's "that thou knowest is common, all that lives must die," and brings that in. And then he moves to thinking about Arthur Hallam. Arthur Hallam, no, he says, "an utterance of the words need not go in any specific direction. This is only one obvious pitfall of tone, with the poem being written, and therefore an utterance of absence, as well as an utterance about absence, helps us to see what speech has to manage at times of bereavement, helps us listen for a true tone of consolation. Arthur Hallam had felt that letters let us down, when we seek intimacy of converse. He wrote to Emily Tennyson, this is Arthur Hallam, "how wretched it is to be thrown back into the region of letters after treading the giddy heights of existence in which your dear presence and converse had placed me. And oh, it is sad to think how little a letter gives one. Yours today is all precious sweetness, yet it tells but a few moments of your life, a few thoughts of your mind, and it contains no looks, no tones. That is the great, deplorable, almost irremediable loss." Eric goes on, "no looks, this is that, no looks, no tones. The body and the voice are withdrawn from writing. This withdrawal is like death, but being a model of death, it may then enable us to contemplate actual deaths without being led by our own pain and bewilderment to wish for rapid certainties about what has happened to the dead person. If to J.S. were a treatise, it might have a responsibility to argue that people do or do not survive their deaths, but in the poem, what is at issue is not the correctness of a general conclusion, but a matter of conduct in the face of particular loss. No metaphysical certitude of itself guarantees tactful and apprehensive behavior. But Tennyson tries to behave just in this way, as he writes. Hallam thought the loss of tone an irremediable loss. Tennyson turns the loss to a means of humane delicacy. For the voice in the poem is not withdrawn from writing, but into it, preserved by the lines, in sight of resuscitation, poised in air.
With Eric, there was certainly in those crisis days, among the infamous things were the late night performances in his bedroom. Particularly loud versions of Blue Reed's Heroin, Eric on electric guitar, at 2 o'clock in the morning, which would bring the porters round pleading for silence, which never really actually happened. And I was playing violin with him in those days, and I'm not going to do Heroin today, it doesn't really work on its own. But I thought I would do, I've joined a long procession of things which Eric wouldn't have liked, which is a traditional Irish song called Father Cross. I say he wouldn't have liked it. He certainly did like folk music in what he used to call his stupid period. But what he'd have thought of this later on, it didn't matter a bit. Anyway, this is just a song of farewell, and it seemed appropriate. So I'm going to improvise a little bit and then sing the song. And then, let's see. Called Parting Glass, some of you may know.
Thank you.
spent is in good company, and all the harm I ever done, alas, it was to none but me. And all I've done for want of wit to memory now I can't recall. So fill to me the parting glass. Good night and joy be with you all. Of all the comrades there I had, they're sorry for my going away, and all the sweethearts there I had, they'd wish me one more day to stay. But since it falls unto my lot that I must rise, and you may not come to me, parting glass, good night and joy be with you.
Thank you. take requests.
Okay, this is it. That was great. That was you did great.
Come on. Give me a kiss.
Thank you.
Your brother's voice.